Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Fermanagh GAA TV and radio. As you know, as part of our efforts to keep you entertained and upskilled, we are this evening launching a new series of coaching information shows. We will have a number of high-profile coaches joining us in the coming weeks, but this evening I'm really delighted to welcome one of Ulster's top coaches, that's Stephen Poacher, to the show. Stephen is a PE teacher with St. Joseph's Boys High School in Newry. He's a former Carlow senior coach for 3 years. He was with the Carlow County. And of course, he's the current Down under 17 coach. Stephen, you're very, very welcome to Fermanagh GAA TV and radio.
Thanks very much, Jared. It's an absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Good man. How's things going down in the Mourne County?
Yeah, going well. Just saying earlier, Jared, we're adapting to the new norm. You know, this is the first one of these webinars that I've actually taken part in. I've watched a good few. I'm taking part in a few actually over the next coming weeks. I have a few coming up, but this is probably the new norm for us as coaches, and it's a great, for me, it's a great learning process. You know, for me, sharing is learning, obviously, and it's fantastic to see the amount of resources being shared these days.
Yeah, well, we're delighted to have you on board. And I suppose before you get into your presentation, one question I'd love to throw at you. You're a young man, Stephen, but you've built yourself up a very high profile in terms of coaching. You must have started at an early age. And if so, what got you really interested and really keen in the coaching aspects?
That's an interesting question, Jared. Yeah, I suppose go back to when I was playing as a youngster. You know, Dad was our manager and at soccer, actually. He was the soccer manager. And, you know, I would have taken a lot of inspiration, obviously, from him. I would have taken a lot of inspiration from some of the managers I would have played under in Gaelic as well, you know, and very fortunate to play under some really good managers and some really bad ones too. But
Do you want to name the bad ones?
but you learn from all experiences. But no, I suppose my first venture into coaching, Jared, believe it or not, was as a fresher face than I am now, as a 19-year-old over in Manchester at university. Took on the mantle of player coach or player manager, if you want to call it, with the Manchester Metropolitan University Gaelic team. And you know, we had to establish a sponsor for ourselves with some bloody good players. We had a couple of Tyrone men, we had a couple of Down men, the Donegal lads. You know, we actually had a really good team, a team that was actually full of lads who half of them would have actually used it into county football. And we were very unlucky not to make it across the water back home to the Trench Cup, you know, and we just missed out on that, and beaten after extra time. But I was coaching and managing the team back then, took a great interest in coaching from that. And then obviously my degree was centred around teaching and coaching, you know. And for me, Jared, teaching is very similar to coaching, and particularly PE. Yeah. So I've spent my whole life, more or less, you know, engrossed in coaching. And obviously, when you take up your first coaching, like your first teaching role, sorry, at 22 years of age, you know, you're straight into taking teams as well. So, look, I retired relatively young. I probably harbour some regrets over quitting playing so early and quit playing at 30 and took on the management job at Inrae with Martin Clark's club in Down at the time. But no regrets. No regrets from the coaching front. Delighted. And probably, Gerard, one of the reasons why I've had such a diverse range of experience is probably the reason why maybe that quitting that little bit earlier as a player and throwing myself into coaching a bit earlier than most, you know.
Yeah, well, fair play to you, because you really have, you know, built yourself up to be a really top class coach. And anybody that I've spoke to and anything I've read in the papers about you, Stephen, has been very, very complimentary about you, the innovative way, I suppose, that you coach teams. So, look, we're looking forward to hearing from you this evening. So I'm not going to stand in the way anymore. We'll get a chat maybe after you go through your presentation, Stephen. But for now, I'll hand over to yourself to take us through your presentation.
No problem, Jerk. I'll just get it up the screen here.
No bother.
I think we are we're ready to go, are we?
Yeah, that looks good on my end.
Yeah. So more or less, Jared, the presentation tonight obviously is what it says on the screen. Planning a better session. I had played with the word planning a perfect session, but for me there is no perfect session, you know. Different sessions throw up different things, and I think that the more prepared you are and the better prepared, I suppose you learn this from teaching as well. You expect the unexpected. I know you used to get an advert on TV about dangerous driving, expect the unexpected. And I suppose in coaching, you have to expect the unexpected as well. You might arrive at a session with less numbers than what you planned for, but if you plan, it obviously makes it much more easier for yourself. So we'll split into the very first slide there, as you can see, is overview. Okay, so we're looking at a number of things. The time of the session. What I mean by that is obviously how long the session is going to take. Is it going to be a short session? Is it going to be a long session? And it links in with the second one, then the time of year. I suppose in pre-season, the mistake a lot of coaches make in pre-season is that they maybe plan their first couple of sessions in pre-season too long. And what actually tends to happen then is there's obviously a higher risk of injury then for lads. So sometimes I actually think in pre-season it's better to have your sessions limited to about 40, 45 minutes initially and obviously grow from that. Sometimes, you know, we go in with this philosophy of let's make the first session the hardest session thing, and it's probably slightly wrong. Mid-season, peak season might take on a different shape. So you might train for 45, 50 minutes at a high intensity, but then you might have a 25, 30-minute walk-through tactical session if that's the case. And I suppose that links on then to the next level, you know, which is the age group of the group. So under 10s, you're not going to have under 10s on the pitch for that length of time. You know, for me, you know, the length of time you spend under age, I'll talk about it in greater length after the presentation. But I do have my own thoughts on how under age should be trained and the length of time you spend on the field compared to senior level. You know, for example, at Carlow, if we were training and we might have done an hour in season, maybe at the end of that session, we might have planned 18 kickouts and maybe just run through them. And the lads were quite happy and content to stay on the field for that time, you know. Obviously, the focus of the session is important. Is it a skill-based session? You know, the weather that we have in this country dictates that a lot of our stuff, maybe particularly pre-season, particularly early in the year, can't be outside. So therefore, if you've got access to an indoor wall of any capacity, you can do a fantastic skills-based session. Totally working on skills, and I know a lot of people think that this is a new phenomenon using a wall and a ball. It's been around for a long time, because yeah. I spent many of my childhood kicking a ball off my parents' gable wall and spent many a happy hour. But I suppose with modern technology, that skill has slightly gone now. But is it a games based focus? Is the session going to be games based? Is it going to be tactical gameplay focus, or is it a conditioning focus? You know, is it a session that you're going to be based around, you know, condition of the players, obviously, hopefully, with through the ball. And then external factors, I've thrown in the weather. You have to facilitate you obviously have to take into account the weather, the facilities. And I suppose I'm throwing that in from my own experience. You know, I was managing Ballyhole for 6 years, and our pre-season would have been done on a very, very small pitch. We were very limited in what we could do. You know, you're not hanging down to Carlow to a training centre with four sand-based beautiful pitches like bowling greens. You've no issues there. But a lot of clubs don't have that access to that, don't have those facilities. So you have to take that all into account when you're planning your session and that. And then I've thrown in transport and time. You know, how are the players, for example, I'll give you a school example. I spent 17 years in St. Columbans, Kilkeel, and the late bus to Longstone and Newcastle was maybe 10 past four. So by the time you got the players out onto the field at 25 past three, half three, you really only had that 40-minute window, and that's something that you have to plan for as well. That's just a slight overview of what you'd be looking at when you're leading into a session. The meet and greet, first part of the session. Well, obviously you arrive early and set the session up. Might not be achievable if you're working and you're coming straight from work, but you know, you're not going to be taking an underage team or a senior team on your own. If there's other coaches that can be there to help you set the session up, excellent. Getting there early allows time for one-on-ones, and I think that's vitally important. I think communication is a massive, massive part of coaching. You know, that one-to-one time, and not so much to the star player. You know, maybe the little cornerback, wee Jimmy or wee Johan, who doesn't, you know, grab the headlines in training or isn't that predominant, strong player that stands out, might be a little bit introvertish. Those couple of seconds, that 10, 20 seconds of one-on-one with him might be a great opportunity, just even to get to know that person a little bit better. Opportunity to work with your free takers, something I would always insist, free takers and inside forwards. You know, getting down to training early, 10 footballs, edge of the 14, middle of the 14, the other edge of the 14, right foot, left foot, either feet, you know, from the middle. And just that, just building a bit of confidence in themselves, building a routine with your free takers. Maybe walk through gameplay elements, maybe pull your two midfielders to one side, opportunity to work with them. And this is all before the session. We're trying to squeeze little bits in because our time really is limited when we think of two sessions a week, 1 hour, or three sessions a week, 1 hour, whatever it happens to be. So you have to maximise the time that you have. And I think also as well, psychologically puts the group in the right frame of mind. Speak to the whole group and set a little focus or goal for the session. I think that really helps players when you set a little focus or goal. You know, just give a player, right, for example, if you're a defender, you know, your focus is just to make two tackles. If you're a forward, your focus is to press a kick out, get a score, whatever happens to be. You just set little focus and goals for the session. Pre-pitch warm-up, I suppose, you know, this is the new modern craze of the young lads arriving now with foam rollers because they see, you know, Philly McMahon or Kieran Kilkenny getting off the bus at Croke Park with a foam roller under their arm, so they all feel they need one. There's a few myths and there's a few realities surrounding it, I suppose. There's no scientific evidence that a foam roller actually works for you. But from speaking to some top physiotherapists, they do tell me that, you know, it's more a psychological thing. It puts the players in the right frame of mind mentally. If you arrive in the change rooms and you see lads slumped in the corner, you know, hands in the pockets, chatting to each other, or you see lads down foam rolling in the zone, thinking about what's coming ahead, you know, and it's great for mobility, soreness, and it just more or less actually puts them in the right frame of mind. And obviously your pre-pitch warm-up as well, particularly at senior level, a lot of teams now are using bands. And bands are a great activation and a great opportunity for players just to get that little bit of a pre-warm-up done. You know, I don't know about others, but whenever I was playing or whenever I'm still doing a bit of jogging or a bit of running, I need that 8 to 10 minutes before I even go for the run just to open up the hips and do whatever I have to do. And I suppose even for older players, it's very beneficial. There's no massive scientific evidence to show that stretching is a major advantage for young players. But again, it's creating a culture, creating a habit and habit of routine, which is obviously going to benefit them later. Pitch-based warm-up. Okay, so straight away, ball contact. For me, it has to be ball contact. I know the GAA brought out their Activate warm-up years ago, and it was a fantastic initiative. But it led, I think, to a lot of teams, 15, 20 minutes of warm-up without a ball being touched. And it was something that really started to grind me a little bit. And there's no reason why you can't include all those, you know, squatting, jumping, lunging, etc. There's no reason why you can't include all those with a ball in your hands. The school warm-up I would take part in would be very, very basic, very simplistic. Groups of three. The lads are sick hearing me talking about 200 touches, but it's just a simple little thing. You know, if they're getting 200 touches of the ball in the warm-up, it puts them in a great frame of mind then for the rest of the session. A simple low-intensity pulse rate is an exercise, progressing to medium or high, and that's just simply jogging, walking, you know, a little bit of skipping, marching, you know, and some fun games. You know, if you're working with an underage team, even a 4v1 in a square, you know, man in the middle, try and tag another player, just simple little things just to get the blood flowing and get the pulse raised. mobility and flexibility work. You know, you're into your, nowadays, the simple quad stretch and the hamstring stretches have seemed to have gone. It's the knee hugs and the dead bugs and the world's greatest stretches and all these fancy terminology that these S&C coaches are coming out with. But they are important, and they do open up the body, they do open up the hips, and it's a great opportunity then for players to go into the session really, really loose and supple. A structured skill-based exercise, I always like to include something that's structured and a drill. And what I mean by a drill, and I'm very dead against drills, straight line drills, because we change direction in the game about 360 times on average, so I'm dead against moving in a straight line. But, you know, if you even have a bit of traffic, as I call it, you know, you're just simply talking about two cones facing each other, another two coming across each other, bit of traffic in the middle where they have to sidestep, protect the ball, get through, get their head up, offload the pass, simple stuff like that. And then some form of game to incorporate game-related and pace movements. I think we sometimes get too carried away in pitch-based warm-ups, particularly at senior county level. I do feel it can be an egotistical time for a coach to start showboating some fantastic games and drills that he has. And I always find them brilliant because I'm there taking notes and stealing ideas for my session next month. I think warm-up at underage level, you know, school has taught me an awful lot, but even for big school games that we would have been involved in the past, Ulster finals and All-Ireland finals just from years ago, it still would have only been 10, 15 minutes of a warm-up. You know, you can get too wrapped up in it, particularly at underage level. Skill refinement, I suppose a big talking issue, you know, is how do we develop skill? Well, obviously, the earlier you start, the better, and I'll talk about that in a second. But skill refinement, more or less, the repetition of a skill during a session will lead to becoming, you know, obviously more efficient and perform subconsciously. It's a bit like a tennis player, you know, just rehearsing the serve, rehearsing the forehand, rehearsing the backhand. Once they're doing that time and time and time again, a golfer, the same example, you know, but yet we maybe go against the grain in that respect, and we maybe have, you know, in a skill refinement exercise, the player might kick the ball twice in training, whereas it's something that should be done maybe 100, 200 times or whatever. Okay, hope's not a particular skill, whether that be a straight line, whether that might be a game-related drill. Yeah, I spoke about this at 4 in the warm-up, introducing traffic, avoiding straight lines. Demonstration's important for younger players. So one of the things that I have said before, some coaches have found themselves that they aren't particularly confident in demonstrating, particularly maybe people that are coming in from non-GAA backgrounds. And what I've said is, just pick out the best player in the group and get them to demonstrate the exercise for you. And that's a great way of actually getting around that, you know. But demonstration is vitally important, absolutely vitally important for a younger player. A variety of skills to be refined. That could be a hand pass, kick pass, pick up, a catch, a block, score, solo, bounce, all the skills of the game. And I think it's important as well that you try and incorporate as many of those skills into the warm-up as you possibly can. But if you're doing something skill refinement in every session, try to be focused on one of those rather than three or four of them. And here's an interesting one, folks, for us all. Approximately 90% of technical ability is acquired before the adolescent period. So in age groups under 6 to under 12, fun and technique are the two high priorities. But if you think about that, 90% of a kid's technical ability is acquired before the adolescent period. So it shows how important it is that the skill is hammered into them. They're like sponges at that age, and they need to be absorbing so much. And I remember speaking to a former Sigerson manager, actually, in Jordanstown once, and he said to me, you know, some of the best footballers in Ulster were arriving in Jordanstown, and they had fantastic body composition and fantastic muscle mass, but he says 90% of them couldn't kick past the ball. I remember Martin Clark talking about Australia and his time in Australia at 25, 26, if you couldn't kick past the ball, you just simply didn't kick it, you know. So it's a very, very interesting one. Game-related activity. Well, the game, obviously, for me, in a session, when you're planning a session, it should be, the session should be centered around games, a games-based approach. And this could be a number of different games. It could be a small-sided game, a conditioned game, fun games, pressure games, or even tactical gameplay. The majority of the sessions should consist of games. Now, you could pick one of those themes. You could pick a number of those themes. Take, for example, a small-sided game. That probably suits a club or a county with smaller numbers. We would have found ourselves very fortunate that we could have trained Ricardo most nights with with over 30 players, so you can facilitate a full game. But not all club sides can do that. Not all underage teams can do that. At school, I would have found a panel, small panels of 17, 18, and you have to adapt. And you have to use smaller-sided games, condition games, maybe 4v4s, 3v3s, 5v5s, 6v6s, whatever it happens to be. The benefits of taking this game-based approach are obviously huge. You know, you see there are constant regular decision-making opportunities. You know, you want to try and create thinking footballers. And I think as a coach, the more situations, the more times you're putting that player into a situation in training, and the more times you're exposing them to that situation, it's obviously going to improve their decision-making process whenever they cross the white line. It's also going to improve their communication, as it says there as well, their ability to communicate with others around them. More 2v2, 2v1, 3v2 attack and defending situations. You know, what happens in a game when your two forwards are true 2v1 against the defender? Do they make the right decision? Do they draw the defender and take him out with a pass? Goalkeeper's coming out. Do they slip the ball across for a palm finish? And you're scratching your head after the game going, why did he not get that ball? Why did he do this? Why did he do that? Well, the reality is, if he's not exposed to those situations when you're planning your session and you're preparing for a session, if he's not exposed to those situations, then obviously he's not going to make the correct decisions in the game. Constant directional changes. I've mentioned before the analysis of games that in a game, in a normal game, a player will change direction approximately 360 times. Therefore, it's mystifying why we would run games, or sorry, why we'd run drills, or why we would run players in straight lines. I think players should be using their agility as much as possible. And agility is the ability to push off, you know, obviously both sides at pace, to change direction at pace. And that's improving your right foot and your left side. You know, if a young player is turning, and you've got to spot this as a coach, if a young player is turning off his right-hand side all the time, as he grows older, if he's a forward, there's a couple of forwards, for example, within down club football that I know straight away what side they'll turn to because I've been watching them grow and develop for years, and they've always worked on that stronger side. Whereas if you have a forward and you're a defender and you don't know he's going to push off left or right, and that develops through obviously agility work and obviously putting players into a situation where they have to change direction. Other benefits, exploiting and creating space. You know, I talked about this before recently, a couple of coaching corner shows I've done there recently. We're talking about movement in the forward line. How do you create movement in the forward line? And, you know, I said a very simple thing. You know, you're saying to young fellas, right, if you're in space, you know, vacate the space and someone else occupy it. And you're just trying to get players to think like that. You know, get out of space and then fill space. And if you get players, because what you're actually doing there is moving. And that might sound very, very straightforward, but young players don't know how to move. They don't know how to leave the space, and they don't know how to actually go and occupy the space. And if you can create little situations in training and little games in training that get players to understand how to do this, then it's fantastic. A simple little exercise, you know, for example, a 3v1 in a small square where after they pass the ball, they have to move outside the line of the square and come back in. Now, I'm only coming off the top of my head with that one. But if you have a young player that understands to give that ball and then move and go and create space and present for the player the ball, it's a bit like the young lad, the coach shouting to the young lad at in training or in games, you know, create an angle, and he's looking at him going like, I was never that good at maths at school, coach, you know. But you have to actually give the players experience of doing this. Experience, performance, skills under pressure. So you go back to your drills. You know, if we have a drills-based approach and our session is geared around fancy drills and moves, there's no pressure on the player. You know, I would never run a scoring exercise, and I don't call it a shooting exercise, I call it scoring, because we want to use positive language. And if we're running a scoring exercise, we will run that scoring exercise with pressure. You know, so we'll obviously have a defender close by. It mightn't be full-on pressure. They mightn't be engaging in tackles, but they'll certainly be under some form of pressure. I think that's vitally important. Players can learn how to make and break tackles, and this is probably an underestimated aspect of the benefits of building your stationary games. Because you can get any young fella or young girl to go and slap a ball out of someone's hands, you know, and get that confidence to make a tackle. You know, go and slap that ball, you know, make contact with the ball, because technically that's what you're meant to do in a tackle, is make contact with the ball. So you're getting that young player to make contact with the ball. But the other young player sees a gap and will go to that gap, and as soon as that gap closes, will panic and will turn and come back. And it's getting that young player the confidence and the experience to break tackles, because that's a very underestimated skill. And then the last thing, developing certain life skills, working as part of a team, communication, social interaction. And this is a massive one for me, and particularly our current generation of mobile phone gurus, is the encouragement and the development of early leadership qualities. And I think over the last few years, you know, particularly in my own county here, you know, we've probably been bereft of an enormous amount of leaders. And I think that is just detriment in society in general. I think society in general lacks a bit of leadership quality. Some of the leaders we're looking at these days, but we look at the development of early leadership qualities. You know, having someone within a group, providing them with situations that they actually have to take control, they have to make decisions. I love playing a little game in school. We'll play a game, we'll break them into two groups, nominate a leader, you know, right, talk for 30 seconds, what went well, what didn't go so well, you know, chat among yourselves, what are you going to do next? And you'll hear little things popping up. You'll hear players taking responsibility, you'll hear players taking ownership, and it develops their social interaction as well. And I think that's vitally important that you include that in a session when you're planning. Well, how can we modify games? Last little thing there in games is, we're very straightforward, so space, time, equipment, and players. So this is vitally important. This is extremely important, actually, depending on the age group that you're planning for. So if I'm planning for a senior session, and 90% of the training at senior level, we would have had a score implemented into the game that we were playing. The game would always finish with a score. Because ultimately, that's what you want to do. And I remember thinking to myself, I've been asked this question those times, Stevie, could you run that game with an under-10 team? Of course you could. And I have done. I suppose I'm in a very unique position that, you know, on a daily basis, I could be working with under-10 or under-12 players in school or 11-year-olds. And that evening, you could be working with senior county players or senior club players or minor players. So you get a wide, diverse range of coaching. And it's great for you because you learn how to modify and adapt games pretty easily. And if you find that a game isn't working, stop and modify it. So what do I mean by modify it? So we're running a scoring exercise for an under-16 team. And you find that we're not getting enough scores off. We're not creating enough chances. We're not getting enough shots off in goal. So what you do is then you bring the game closer to the goal. So you might have started that game 45 yards out. For senior level, it might be 60 yards out. But let's now bring it into 35 yards out. You know, so the players have less ground to travel, obviously, before they make that decision. The time, senior level, the game might run for 90 seconds. Under 14s, you might only run the game for 40 seconds or a minute before they start to tire. And the time would obviously be dictated by the time of the year as well. If it's pre-season, you'll run the game a little bit longer. So the players are obviously working on their aerobic capacity, okay, and they're traveling at a little bit lower speeds, okay, so they're working on their aerobic endurance. Whereas maybe in championship time, your time might be a lot shorter, so that the games are more explosive, more dynamic, okay, and it suits the particular time of the year. The equipment, how many footballs you have, depending obviously how many players you have. And again, players, you know, if you've got big numbers and you're running a 5v5 game, why not run it on both sides of the field? So you're 5v5 working into one goal, 5v5 working into the other goals. Your coaches spread out as well. So that's how you're going to modify and adapt games, pretty straightforward. Skill refinement with fatigue. So I think it's important we throw this in when planning a session, later in a session. So a lot of our scoring exercises or a lot of our skill exercises are done early in the session, and then we go to games and we never go back to the skill. We never practice the skill, or we never put them under pressure, fatigued. So I think it's very, very important to perform some form of skill execution while we're fatigued in the session. And what I mean by that is obviously later in the session, when minds are tired and decisions obviously then start to slack and start to drop a little bit. An important note though, if you are planning on doing that in a session and introducing that to a session, don't try and introduce a new skill at that stage, because obviously you don't want players to interfere obviously with the technique of a new skill. Only when they're confident and feel comfortable with that skill. And can the players at that time concentrate that high level of skill? Because again, if you look at the picture there of I think it's Dean Rock there, you know, those players at Dublin, late in games, they make the right decisions late in games when other teams are fatigued and other teams are tired. And again, that comes down to great and effective coaching on the training ground. And then the last slide, a fun activity. I think this is critically important. No matter what level you work at, but particularly underage level, you know, always finish with a bit of fun. And I think that's crucially important to your session. Young lads might come to the session, it might be the only bit of fun they get that day. You know, they might have had a bad day at school, they might have fell out with a brother or sister, they might have fell out with mum and dad, they might have been out the door in a bad form. And they come to your session, they're looking at a little bit of release, and I always try and leave the lads smiling at the end of the session, whether it's telling a joke, whether it's a bit of banter, whether it's a little bit of ball wrestling, a little bit of shadow boxing, some chain tag, whatever it happens to be, some form of fun. And believe it or not, you'll be so surprised and so shocked if you plan that into your sessions with senior teams as well, how much the senior players will enjoy it, because really and truly, we're all big kids at heart, and we all love a little bit of spontaneous nature at times. And then eventually the cool down. And again, a cool down, I've read a few articles recently saying that cool downs are scientifically not actually of any benefit, but I do feel it's always a great chance at the end of training just have a gentle stretch, bring the body temperature down, bring the pulse rate down, you know, an opportunity to educate young players in particular on what stretches they should be doing, you know, getting them in good routines, good habits, and then a real quick recap of the session, a little bit of feedback, and maybe send the players away with a little bit of positivity. So that's the planning a better session, guys.
Excellent. Excellent, Stephen, I have to say. You ran through that very, very effectively there. And I suppose the thing that jumped out at myself there was, you know, it's simplified. You've simplified everything there. You know, it's ordinary layman's terms that anybody coach starting out, or whether you're a long time coaching, you can understand your presentation very, very well, the way you've presented there. But I suppose that comes from experience, Stephen. You know, a lot of thought has went into planning sessions. Evidently, that's the key thing from your perspective.
Oh, absolutely, Joe. You know, I think if you go in blind, it's like anything. If you go into school, and again, I go back to teaching, I refer to teaching quite a bit, and I suppose I'm a big John Wooden fan. You know, John Wooden, the great English teacher, American English teacher, yeah. Who's also, you know, one of the world's greatest coaches, basketball coach, and read a lot of Wooden's books and go back to a lot of the stuff. You know, he references teaching quite a bit. And one of the things they talked about is you know, being a good teacher, you know, preferably helps you become a good coach. And I think in teaching, you know, planning and preparation is key. It's absolutely key, because if you go into a group of 30 kids into a classroom or a football pitch or whatever it happens to be, and you have nothing planned, you'll get found out pretty quickly. So it's very important that you have something. And something like, I used to laminate all my sessions of about 200 sessions online, where in my sort of my documents that I can refer to now and again and pull the games from, and I used to print them off and laminate them when I was younger, but I don't have the time to do that now. So what I just do now is Hold a little bit of paper up, have a small little bit of paper the size of maybe this here mobile phone, size of that, shoved in the pocket, some bullet points on it, maybe some coaching points on it as well. And very, very seldom, Jared, would I ever, probably never would I ever go into a session blind. You know, I'd always have something on paper. And particularly if you're working with bigger numbers as well, you know.
Yeah. Early in your presentation there, Stevie, you mentioned about a youth team and the difference maybe between taking a youth team session, and if you look at maybe under 10s, and then you say maybe around that juvenile age range, and then senior, for example, how do they differ? You're maybe make a mention of that, particularly about under 10s.
Yeah, but no, I think it's important. I think it's important that, well, a number of things. Your language, and I don't mean your language as in bad language, I mean your language as in how you approach, you know, your coaching language. You talked about simplifying things. You know, I suppose I found this out through experience this year. You know, having worked with Carlo for 3 years at senior at the county level, and you're dealing with players who, you know, have represented their country, the likes of Brendan Murphy, represented their province, you know, at national level, have won championships, club championships, you know, have played in some big games in Crow Park. And you're working with those players, and then you're coming back to work with 15, 16-year-olds in your county minor setup. And I actually remember phoning Kieran McKeever, who's the Armagh manager. And I remember saying to McKeever one night, I was pulling the hair in my head. I was going, Kieran, I can't get through these bats. You know, and he says, Stevie, I'm telling you now, he says, you're moving down tenfold. And like, I had to go right back to like nearly, you know, retraining myself, re-educating myself, right, I'm going to have to really pull this back. And you have to show a great danger of patience. I think patience is key with underage players. And yeah. I think it obviously differs at under 10 level. The under 10 level, obviously, you want them having lots of fun. You know, you want them having as much ball contact as possible. Ulster GAA have got some fantastic resources on the pathway to senior football. I done something for Ballyhooly years ago, the pathway to senior football.
Yeah.
Came out, and it was something very similar. And one of the things we had down, you know, at all age groups, bar senior, and even senior, has to have an element of it. It was fun, obviously. You know, fun should exist in everything, in every session you do, yeah. You know. But
yeah.
I think the best way of describing it as you move up the grades is that, you know, good coaching for me, and it's a quote I've always taken with me, is it's probably taken, right word I'm looking for, it's taking players out of their comfort zone without taking them out of their depth. And I think that's vitally important, you know, that you take players out of their comfort zone without taking them out of their depth.
Challenge them.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. You know. Well, one thing you mentioned there as well, and something I've always been interested in, is thinking players. What percentage of players are naturally thinking players, and what percentage have you to coach them to think? I presume that's what you were referring to earlier.
Yeah, well, listen, the great John Morrison, Lord rest him, John used to talk about this game sense, you know, when he had a book, he had actually a couple of books, great books, himself and Ger had a couple of great books there on game sense, developing game sense. And I think you can develop game sense in every player, but there's certain players are just so football intelligent. And you know, you think of players like a Marty Clark, a Mark Cole, Brian McGuigan, you know, real smart, gifted players who could spot a pass that other players couldn't, you know, real great game sense. And like I used to have a couple of real wee rogues at school in Kilkeel, you know, and more like great wee characters. And you know, you wouldn't have got much out of in the English and the maths class, the science class, the teachers to give it off with them. But you see on a football field, some of the most intelligent footballers I ever worked with, you know, and were so smart, so cute, you know, really skillful, but it wasn't the skill, it was the decision-making journey, you know, and that's the key thing, the decision-making, and how you...
But can you coach that, Stephen?
Absolutely. Yeah. Like, don't get me wrong, you're going to hit a plateau with a lot of players, and there's going to be players that just maybe can't get past that, but you definitely can develop that, and as I said, the only way probably to develop that is by putting them into situations where they have to think. I think if you continually give players, spoon-feed players information, you know, I think of the Dublin thing, and I listened to the stories coming back from their camp that the Dublin players are expected to present the game plan to the squad. And it's something I sort of trialled this year. I'm actually managing Bryansford seniors this year. And
yeah.
Something I trialled in the lockdown, and made a couple of fantastic videos, actually. Some of the players dressed up in three-piece suits and had a tackle board. It was good fun. Like, but we got them to send a little video into the group and present the game, different parts of the game plan. And I think players, and I was actually shocked when I stepped back, I was, these boys have an understanding, because when they're asked to actually do it and participate in it, they develop an understanding of it. But if I'm just constantly telling them, you know, I can't remember the exact quote, but it's like, tell me and I'll forget, show me and I'll understand, involve me and I'll, you know. And I think that's the key thing, you know, give the players the ownership, effective questions, huge as well, you know, get them into small groups, get them thinking, get them talking. You know, how, like, what went well? It's nearly the teaching thing, two stars and a wish. So, you know, you said to them, right, two things that went well, lads. And they're looking and they're going, well, we moved the ball really well. The presentation was good, excellent. Anything else, you know, good numbers and support, brilliant. One thing we could do better, end product, we didn't get the score, Stevie. Right, perfect, let's work on that now. You know, and you're trying to get lads in to think, you know, and I suppose it's just putting them in those situations and enjoy those.
And one other thing there that you might have, a few quick fire questions for you then as well. But you talked about game related activity versus skills refinement. What percentage of your coaching session, you know, should be made up of both? Which is the most important, the other as well?
Great question. I was down in Newbridge actually last year. Paddy Gribben, teaching with them in the morning time, asked me to go down and do a little workshop for the underage coaches in Newbridge. And I arrived down on the Friday night to take the session with the coaches of the under 14 team. And the club had a fantastic hall across the pitch, across the road from the pitch in Newbridge.
Hmm.
I said to Paddy, like, there's no reason why they couldn't pull those young lads into training at 6:45. Bring your trainers for 15 minutes, 20 minutes in the hall. Have a skill-related warm-up with a wall and a ball. Every player bring a ball.
Right,
ball per player.
Yeah.
You know, have that 10. I've made this argument so many times. If you had facility, if you had access to a wall, imagine what you could do in 10, 15 minutes before you go into the bulk of your session. And then your 40-minute pitch session could be just games based. You know, can you imagine the difference you would make to the skill level? Remember chatting to McGee there a few years ago, Kieran, and I met him for coffee in Newry, and it was a good chat about football. You know, I'm always looking to pick people's brains at the highest level, and he made a brilliant point to me. He says, like, if you look at it like, you know, a golfer goes to the driving range and hits 100 balls, you know, there's not a golfer on this planet won't own their own golf balls, or a tennis player that won't own their tennis ball. How many of our footballers actually own their own ball and carry their own ball with them? You know, I'll go back to the Marty Clark thing in Australia when he first landed there. Every single player was expected to be carrying a ball around. He says the senior pros were walking around in the corridors, bouncing the ball on the wall, bouncing the ball to each other, even in getting their food, you know, bouncing the ball when they're waiting on their food. Just the ball everywhere they had. It was religion. It was just, you know, religiously hammering home their skill. And I think a lot of your skill work, I think if you're trying to, probably the point I'm coming to is, if your session, our time is actually very, very limited with our squads. Okay, so you have to maximize it out of your time the best possibly can. So at senior level, for example, you're not going to waste a half an hour, 40 minutes trying to get somebody to kick past the ball. We can't do it at 24. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, so so at underage level, obviously, it's quite important, but it's trying to get the balance, you know?
I'm conscious of the time, Stephen. I really appreciate you sitting in with this evening. It's really, really enjoyable. So I'm going to last maybe 4 or 5 minutes here, a couple of quick fire questions at you, if you don't mind, just squeeze in as many as I can here. How many weeks pre-season do you recommend for a team? And does this differ from senior to youth?
Well, pre-season is a very debatable one, but, you know, for me, and I've said this before, Joe, I suppose that this is a nice quote for people to take. I've always tried to say to players, you know, don't arrive to training, pre-season training, looking to get fit. I always say to players, arrive at pre-season fit to play football. And my first session is always football at pre-season, you know. And listen, I've trialled a number of different pre-seasons. I've gone early. I've gone early with limited sessions. I've gone later with more sessions. You know, I've spread it out a bit more. And, you know, I like to ease players into it. And I think, look, I think the same Paddy Kelly right thing the other thinks the season's too long, but I don't think the GAA season's too long. I just think the pre-season's too long for a lot of counties. You know, they start in October and they don't kick the ball until February, and I think that that's the problem. So, listen, you're looking at Premiership teams are doing pre-season for 4 or 5 weeks, and I know they're professional, but do we really need much more than 5 or 6 weeks for pre-season senior level? Yeah. Underage level, maybe 2 or 3. You know, because young lads are going to be fit anyway.
Very hard to argue with that, because it's a long season, as you say, and you build up the fitness through the games as well. Tell us your thoughts on fitness testing as part of planning a season, for even for small rural clubs and with limited resources. What would you recommend?
Well, listen, fitness testing is great. You know, you test 3 key things you can test, which is very straightforward. You know, I downloaded the bleep tester one day in the back garden, and me and the girls done it for a bit of fun just to see where we're at, you know. And
did they beat you?
They did, surely. Yeah, they did, surely. But, you know, even a flexibility, even a sit and reach box is very easy to make, you know, and cost effective. And you can test players' flexibility. You know, you're sending them, and it shows them. They said, look at your hamstrings here. Like, you know, you're in trouble here. You need to start working out, do a bit of Pilates, a bit of yoga. But I think they're the key thing with fitness testing. And again, it's not my speciality, but from a PE perspective, I do know that if you're going to test, you need to test regularly. So, if you're testing at the start of pre-season, you need to be testing again in 3 or 4 weeks' time. You need to be testing again in 3 or 4 weeks' time after that. You need to be testing in season. But what tends to happen is players come back, they get tested, and then the test spin, and it's never tested again. You know, so I think it's frankly important that if you are going to test, you know, players are set, and they're set also as well. I think it's important that you use the sort of smarter principle when you're setting goals. There's no point in saying a lad who's hit level 10 in the bleep test, in 3 weeks, I want you at 13. He's not going to be there. You know, so you need to give him a realistic goal. You need to give him an achievable goal, and you need to give him something that he can measure as well. You know, that, oh, okay, over the next 3 weeks, this is what you're going to do. You're going to do an extra running session, and let's see if we can get you to 10.5. You know, and it's realistic, and it gives him a target, and it's obviously achievable for him.
Yeah. So if you're going to use it, you know, you continue to use it, you just don't use it for the first month or two of pre-season and then drop it. You have to
A consistent coach right throughout the season, you know.
Injured players, how do you manage these players during the playing season, and, you know, particularly at club level where you don't have a whole entourage of people to help you and to take rehab sessions? How do you manage that?
Yeah, it's frustrating. It can be frustrating, and I understand people's frustrations. You know, and I used to say to the injured players, I'd always say to them, I would say it publicly in front of the rest of the squad, like, you know, how are you managing your injuries? You know, when did you get injured? Last Friday. This is Wednesday. What have you done since last Friday? You know, and I go back to, you know, a player I would have worked with in the past, Ronan Murder. Ronan would have played for Down for 10 years, and Ballyhole and Stalwart, excuse me, and Ronnie would have talked about getting a dead leg on a Friday night and setting his alarm at 4 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday to get up and ice it. You know, so he fit the fame the following week. And that was the difference in how he was managing his injuries. And you're just saying to players, look, first 48 hours, you're a race. Simple principle, race. You know, it's not, you don't need to be a physio to understand that. The physio can't do anything for the first 48 hours. So what are you doing in those first 48 hours is critical. Avoiding the alcohol intake, you know, avoiding heat, avoiding all those, you know, things that they're not meant to do. And, you know, you go back to the George Graham one where he first took over at I think it was Arsenal, and Arsenal had a injury list. My dad tells me this famous story of, I think, 14 players were injured. So he brought them in for treatment in the morning and treatment in the evening, and they were hitting the M1 in London at 5 o'clock in the evening. He says the injured list cleared up in about 2 weeks. So look, the other thing as well is if you're taking a physio to training, and this is an interesting one, I think if you take a physio to training and the physio's visual and the physio's there, you know, it just, you rub here, you know, and think you get some temptation.
You have more injured players.
Yeah, but listen, but my final point on that, Jared, is keep them involved, you know, get them involved in the session.
Yeah.
Whether that is even just being there when you're talking to the group, you know, the injured players are sitting in the stand or sitting in the sideline, get them in the group, listen to what's going on, listen to the walkthroughs, etc.
Yeah. Two last things, Stephen. Yeah. During these unprecedented times, what can players be doing and how can club coaches support their players? We're going to have no football now, county level or club level, until the 20th of July at the earliest, and probably a lot longer than that. What would you suggest fairly succinctly for players and coaches at this time?
Well, I think do what's best for them. You know, people say, oh, you need to get in a routine, but for me, I don't think you need to be in a routine, because at this time, if you want to lay in some morning, lay in. If you want to get up early, get up early. But I think one key thing, Jared, every day, you know, there should be some form of exercise every day. Whether that be even just walking, whether it be jogging, whether it be a bit of, you know, a wee bit of high intensity running, whether it be a bit of stretching. I've started a routine now where a stretch every day, which I've never done. And, you know, I've never felt as supple and as loose, you know, and don't get me wrong, I'm still sore when I run, but you know, if players can get into sort of an exercise type routine, you know, and it doesn't have to be. The beauty of this is that I spoke to a senior player tonight, actually, and obviously confidentially, I'm not telling you who it was, but he said to me, he says, I've never felt better. He says, I just feel I'm not tied to a timetable, I'm not tied to a regimented training structure, you know, and I think just looking after themselves, you know, physically, mentally, and I think emotionally as well, because social media is poison as well, you know, I think. Try and avoid multiple scrolling of Facebooks and Twitters and Instagram. And I try to limit it to, you know, little sporadic spells during the day, because you can find yourself just engrossed in it, you know. And listen, you know, do something nice for the family. Go for a walk, you know. And listen, and the other thing, as I said to the boys, and I've rolled into the group there many times, I'm here in a support capacity as well. And if they want to speak to someone, lift the phone, you know, and chat to someone. But I think we're close to maybe, you know, things being eased a little bit, where we might be able to, you know, travel down the road and sit in the garden with someone in the next few weeks, hopefully, you know.
Yeah. I think when players get back, whether it be this year or next year, you'll find them refreshed and revitalized, and it'll make, particularly the inter-county level, I think it'll be brilliant next year. The players will be so revitalized and eager. It augurs well for an interesting year. Final question, if you're a new coach starting out or looking to improve, what advice would you give? And I suppose burnout's another thing for coaches as well. I don't know how you stick the pace, but evidently you're doing that very, very well.
Oh, I don't know about that, but no, there's nights you be going to training thinking, how can I lift this again? But you have to put on the big show, and you have to bring the same level of enthusiasm and passion that, you know, you bring to all your sessions, because it will reflect on the group there, you know. But listen, it's a very, very valid point, the burnout thing, because, you know, it's sometimes, and I thought I was a big believer in, like, you know, taking it away, and I wasn't listening, and I kept going, and this is probably coming a good time for me, you know, coming off the back of three exhausting campaigns with Carlo traveling as well. But I would probably change the question you asked me to, what advice can you give any coach? Because whether it's a new coach, whether it's an established coach, or whether it's a really experienced coach, the great John Wooden said he learned probably as much in his last year of coaching as he did in his first year, you know, and I think you never stop learning. You know, you never stop learning, and I think that's a key message to give to any coach. And funny, I noticed on Twitter today, I've started following more bloody PE teachers, and I'm afraid to use the word the UK in case I get in trouble, but I followed more teachers from England and beyond in the last few days, because some of the ideas that are putting up on Twitter is fantastic, you know, and great resources, great material, and it's fantastic. And I think that's a key thing, Gerard, is that, you know, the more obviously sharing, the more opportunities you have. And listen, don't be afraid to go and watch another session. Like I've been across the water now to professional rugby club with the Dragons and Bernard Jack, and I was over at Hearts, and you know, I was up watching Kerry training and watching Tyrone training, and you know, just go and watch these sessions and expand your horizons, and don't just limit it to Gaelic games. You know, there's a world of information out there on the internet as well, and now is obviously a great time for even these things here, like webinars and stuff as well. You know, tune in as much as you can. I have a black book upstairs, and it's not just the names of everybody who annoyed me in it, like, but it's just little notes that I would take, you know, and little bullet points on training sessions, and I might get an idea, it might spark something else, and I'll just jot that down, you know. So just never stop learning and have a pen and a paper handy.
Great stuff, Stephen. That's brilliant stuff. Really, really enjoyed the presentation and that discussion that we had there, and really grateful for your time. And thanks for joining us here on Fermanagh GAA TV and radio, and hopefully we'll get you back on at some other time.
Not a problem, George. Thanks very much. Pleasure. Absolute pleasure.
Good, ma'am. Well, in the meantime, take care of yourself, Stephen. Once again, thank you on behalf of everyone in Fermanagh GAA. That's the first in our series of coaching seminars. And what better man to start off with than Stephen Poacher. And I'm sure everybody that's tuned in tonight will get full enjoyment from Stephen's presentation and pick up many, many tips for coaching and taking their coaching sessions going forward. So we're going to do a few of these, as I've said, and next week we're hoping to have Owen Mooney, listen, Ski Emmett's man, of course, spent a number of years out there in Rockfield in New York, and now back working full-time as a coach in Dublin. So we look forward to Owen's presentation in the next week or so. And remember, there's a series of events that Fermanagh GAA TV are putting out throughout the month of May. So if you go onto the Fermanagh GAA website, you'll see the schedule of events, plenty of chat and plenty of quizzes and plenty of questions. So something hopefully there for everybody to enjoy during this time of lockdown. For now, that's it. Thanks very much for joining us here on Fermanagh GAA TV and radio, and we hope that you keep safe in the intervening period until we meet up again. So keep safe and keep well, and slán.